Well, thank you very much. So, well, as you heard a little bit what I'm going to talk about, it's definitely changing gears here. As some of you might know, a very exciting area in physics in recent years has been studies and uses of ultra-cold atoms. We can, these days, we can cool atoms down to microkelvin and nanokelvin. That's a few millionths to a few billionths of a degree above absolute zero. So that's pretty freezing cold. And when matter gets, and we typically use lasers to do that job, that's sort of new techniques that have been developed. And when matter gets that cold, if you can sort of collect a bunch of particles or atoms, cool them down, they tend to form extremely strange states of matter. And a really good example of that is a Bose-Einstein condensate. It's a state of matter that Bose and Einstein predicted some 80 years ago. And it's only in recent years that it's actually been possible to create this state of matter cleanly in the lab, first seen in the summer of 95 by Eric Cornell and Carl Wieman at Gila in Colorado. And I should say also Bose-Einstein condensates, and I'll get back to more precisely what they are, but Bose-Einstein condensates are also the reason explain why we have these strange phenomena such as superfluidity and superconductivity. This idea of superconductivity, that you can pass currents in certain materials at low temperatures, electrical currents with no resistive losses. And that's, of course, an issue of great importance to help solve our energy problem. If we can start to pass electrical power over long distances with minimal losses, that would be tremendous. So all of that, Bose-Einstein condensates, that whole idea is really behind this phenomena. Now, what we have really been focusing on is to use this Bose-Einstein condensate to manipulate light to the extreme. And I will tell you a bit about how we go about slowing light to the speed of a bicycle, just as you heard in the introduction. And I'll also tell you some of our more recent stuff where we can stop and extinguish a light pulse in one part of space, and then we can regenerate the light pulse in a completely different location and send it back on its way. So to do these kinds of experiments, of course, we need some cold atoms. And with the kind of temperatures we are talking about, you're not going to do that with your sort of standard household kitchen refrigerator. We need a very special atom cooling setup. And just to show you a few pieces here, I mean, the whole setup is typically 2 by 3 meters to give you the scale. And of course, first of all, we need some atoms. We use sodium atoms at the moment. So we have an atom source where we take a chunk of sodium metal and then heat it to a high temperature, typically hundreds of degrees centigrade, to get a good high vapor pressure so we can get a good emission rate of atoms out of this source. And that's great, that works. The only problem is that because of this high temperature, the atoms will come out with very high velocities, really too high velocity that we can effectively use the atoms. So as soon as the atoms come out of the source, we hit them head on with a yellow laser beam that we send up through the system. And then we use radiation pressure to slow these atoms down very dramatically and very rapidly. And then we can load them effectively into what we call an optical molasses, created in the middle of a vacuum chamber by 3 pairs of counterpropagating laser beams tuned just to the exact right frequency relative to the characteristic absorption frequency of these sodium atoms. And when we hit that right frequency, these laser beams will really act as a molasses, a viscous medium for these atoms and will damp their motion down. And we can cool the atoms quickly down to microkelvin. This is what it looks like in real life in the lab when we are laser cooling. As you can see, we have a room full of optics, lasers, yellow laser beams running all over the place, crisscrossing the lab. And this is a laser table in daylight, and there are quite a few man and woman hours that have been going into building this setup, as you can imagine. Over on the side here, we have our ultra-high vacuum chamber where the main action takes place, and I have a close-up view of that. This is where we create our Bose-Einstein condensates and also where we slow light. And we have vacuum flange windows sitting all over this vacuum chamber. You can see one here in a close-up view. And when we laser cool, detection is really easy because we can just look through one of these windows and see these cold atoms by eye. It looks like a little bright sun freely suspended in the middle of the vacuum chamber, about a one centimeter in diameter. Reason we can see it is that that during the laser cooling process, the atoms keep absorbing laser light, laser photons, and then they re-emit spontaneously, so the atoms will fluoresce yellow. Great, so with laser cooling, we get down to microkelvin, but we're not totally happy. We want to get down to nanokelvin. So at this point, we turn the lasers off, and then we turn on the electromagnet, use the fact that the atoms are actually small magnets. They have a small magnetic dipole moment, so we can trap them in a magnetic field minimum. And then once they're happily trapped, we start an evaporative cooling process where we can selectively kick out the hottest, the most energetic atoms in the sample. And then the rest of the trapped atoms trapped by the magnet will collide, re-equilibrate lower temperature. Then we kick the next set of hot atoms out, and then we keep going. And when eventually we start to cool down to just a few nanokelvin, and at that point, all the atoms will start to pile in to a very particular quantum mechanical state, the lowest possible energy state allowed by quantum mechanics for atoms trapped in this magnetic potential here. And at this point where we start to have a whole bunch of particles in the very same quantum mechanical state, that's when we form these Bose-Einstein condensates. They start to act in lockstep, they phase lock. They're all described by the exact same wave function. And the cloud actually turns superfluid. So now in this, this is kind of the most exciting part of the experiment, because now we have this condensate trapped by the magnet. We have roughly 5 million atoms in it, and the size is roughly 100 micron. And now we can start to shoot laser beams towards this condensate and start to create some slow light. Now, how do we create slow light? So I have to show you this one, because I've so far been focusing mostly on the whole motion of the atom and how we try to damp that motion out when doing the cooling process to get the atoms to a standstill. Now I have to turn my attention to the internal structure of an atom. Now sodium is an alkali atom, so that means it has a nucleus and some tightly bound electrons, and then a very, very loosely bound electrons, the valence electron. And that valence electron, again, according to quantum mechanics, can only have very particular energy levels. And those are exactly the energy levels I'm showing here. We see there's the lowest energy levels here. We call it the one state. And that's actually where we find all the atoms after the cooling process. But we notice there's another internal energy level, a two state over here, a little bit higher in energy. And what we do with all the atoms in the one state, we shine a laser beam on. We call it the coupling laser. It's really a yellow laser beam. It's tuned to a frequency such that that frequency matches the energy difference between an upper energy state and this state two. And with this coupling laser, we now re-engineer the optical properties of the atom cloud in such a way that when we now send a laser pulse in, we call it the probe pulse, to non-resonance, tuned to a frequency matching this transition indicated by blue here, we can now slow this light pulse down dramatically. What's happening here? What's happening is that by shining that coupling laser beam on the Bose-Einstein condensate, we are dramatically changing the refractive index of the atom cloud. Now, refractive index, glass, for example, has a refractive index that's a little bit larger than one, a little bit larger than what it is in free space. So that means if I send light through a window, it'll actually slow down a little bit by about 30%. And you would say, well, gee, if I want to slow light down a lot, I should create a medium with a really high refractive index. No, no, that doesn't work at all. Because if I did, I would just create the world's best mirror and reflect all the light back. I will never get any light into the cloud. So what I should rather do, and that's what we are doing, is we should maintain a refractive index that's very close to one, close to what is in free space, but then we generate a very rapid variation of that refractive index as a function of frequency of this probe laser field. And the steeper we can make that slope, the slower we can get a light pulse to go when we send it into the atom cloud, because the signal velocity, or what we call the group velocity of a light pulse, is inversely proportional to that slope. And if we now turn the intensity of the coupling laser way down, we can create a really steep slope. and get incredibly slow light. So with the intensity of the coupling laser, we can directly control the light speed. And what's going on here is we are really playing with quantum mechanics, because with these two laser beams, we are bringing the atoms into a quantum mechanical superposition state. So instead of the atom just being in state one, that's where it started out, we bring it into this superposition state of one and two, where the atom is a little bit in one and at the same time a little bit in state two. And we drive it into actually a very magic superposition state that we call the dark state, where we have the exact right amount of the atom in both states. And that right amount is such that the amount of the atom we find in state two relative to one is determined by the ratio of the strength of the probe laser relative to the coupling laser. So, and we talk about that magic superposition state as a dark state. When the atoms are in that state, they will not absorb any laser light from any of the laser beams, so we have no losses, but the probe pulse will go incredibly slowly. So you can start to see that by forming these superposition states, the light pulse will actually start to write it in its information into the atoms by changing their internal states. Now, and that idea is extremely important for all our experiments. So let me show you the setup that we, the typical geometry for slow light. We can run different geometries, but this is a typical one. So we have the condensate trapped in the middle of the vacuum chamber. We illuminate from the side with a coupling laser, and then we launch the probe pulse and send that in along the long dimension of the atom clouds. And then we want to measure the light speed. We simply sit and wait behind the vacuum chamber for this light pulse to come out. And after it has passed through the system, we send a third laser beam up from down below, and now the atoms will create an absorption shadow in that laser beam, and we can image that absorption shadow onto a CCD camera and take a snapshot of the cloud. And I show you an example up here, cloud that has been cooled to 450 nanokelvin. It's about 200 microns long, 0.2 millimeter. And if I now send a light pulse into exactly this atom cloud, this is what we will record in our experiment. We have the photomultiplier signal here as a function of time in microseconds. We have a blue pulse here. That's a reference pulse just recorded with no atoms in the system, just to set the zero point of the time axis. And then we let atoms into the system, cool them down, launch another light pulse, and now we get the red pulse out. And notice this guy is delayed by 7 microseconds, and that was in a cloud that was only 200 microns long. Now you just divide those two numbers out and you immediately get, in this case, a light speed of 32 meters a second. We just slowed light by a factor of 10 million. And now by just turning the intensity of the coupling laser further down, we can get the light speed even slower, and we can actually get it down to 15 miles an hour, and that's certainly at the point where I can claim that you can beat light on your bicycle. So, at this point, let me also give you a real sense of, before we go on, what it feels like to be a light pulse going through one of our Bose-Einstein condensates. So this little animation here, so we have the condensate illuminated with a coupling laser, then we send the light pulse into the atom cloud, and at the same time I have a reference pulse running here just for comparison. So here's the, we can see what happens when the light pulse starts to enter the atom cloud. The front edge will enter first, of course, and that will start to slow down. But the back edge, that's still out in free space, so the back edge will start to, will run at the normal light speed, so that'll start to catch up to the front edge, and the whole thing will start to compress. And back to the mouse, so now we'll continue. And the more it slows down, the more it compresses and it chucks along, and now it starts to accelerate and just stretches back out when it exits the cloud. And of course in our experiments we are, this is an animation done for light speed reduction of factor of 10. We are talking in the experiments reductions of factors of 10 to 200 million. So that means the light pulse starts out being typically a kilometer long and compresses to only 20 microns, 0.02 millimeters, so less than half the thickness of a hair. So even though our atom clouds are small, the light pulse ends up getting even smaller, so it fits inside the atom cloud. And I should also point out that the light pulse creates an imprint of itself in that condensate, really like a little holographic imprint. And the reason is that within the localized light pulse region, the atom are transformed into these superposition dark states that I talked about. So in the middle of the light pulse, we have a high intensity. So a lot of the atoms are transferred from that initial one state to the two state. But outside the light pulse, the atoms are in their original one state. And that imprint follows along as the light pulse slowly propagates through, and then it exits out. So now, with all this in mind, let me just give you an example of the kind of fun you can have with this system. So instead of just, these are much more recent experiments. So instead of just creating one condensate of state one atoms, let's create two separate condensates. So they're really separately created in two different atom traps. They have never seen each other before. And what I will now do is I will send a coupling laser in from the right, and then send the light pulse into the left, the first condensate there, and slow that down. And what I mean with that, I have again a little animation here. So coupling laser comes in, light pulse comes in, and it slows down, it compresses. And what I then do is I turn off the coupling laser. The light pulse will then come to a grinding halt and turn itself off. But the information that was in the light pulse will not be lost, because that was already imprinted in the atoms through that little holographic dark imprint. And that imprint will actually stay in the atoms, in the atom cloud, but it will start moving now. It'll start moving at a speed of about 200 feet an hour. And 200 feet an hour, so we can see it exits the first condensate and moves out into free space. And we have photographed this whole process in the lab, and you see it over here on the right. We start with the initial two condensates of state one atoms. We then send the light pulse into the first condensate, slow it down, compresses it, stops it, and we turn it off. And then 1.3 milliseconds later, sure enough, we can see a little matter imprint, a little cloud of atoms out there in free space. So what we have actually created out here in free space, that's a matter imprint, what we have created out here is really a perfect matter copy in the form of a little atom pulse of the light pulse that we have already extinguished in that first condensate. And you might ask, gee, why is it boomerang shaped? Well, the reason is that when the light pulse slows down in this first condensate, this light pulse will slow down most along the center line of the condensate where the densities are highest. So the light pulse itself will develop a boomerang shape as it's slowing down. And that's perfectly mimicked by that atom pulse, by that matter copy. And now as time moves on, the matter copy moves on, and it'll eventually reach the second condensate. And if we don't do anything, well, the matter copy will go through that second condensate and come out on the other side. Now, on the other hand, once that matter copy is embedded in the second condensate, if we then turn on the coupling laser again, lo and behold, out comes the light pulse. So what we have now done is we have stopped and extinguished the light pulse in one condensate, the first one here, and then regenerated it from a completely different condensate in a different location. So let's look at the whole process here. So coupling laser comes in, light pulse into the first condensate, we turn it into a matter copy travels across to the second condensate, and then we turn it back into light, and it just moves off. Now, the more you think about it, the weirder this is, really. Because here you have two sets of atoms. You have the matter copy and then the second condensate. These two sets of atoms have never seen each other before, so how on earth can they together figure out to regenerate this light pulse? The secret is that we are dealing with Bose-Einstein condensates. And you can kind of regard the atoms in the matter copy, when we illuminate it with a coupling laser, the atoms will act as little radiating antennas. But under normal circumstances, these little antennas would be completely randomly phased. They would just do each their thing and just scatter some random light. There would certainly be no information content to it. Now, in the presence of that second condensate, that second condensate will phase lock these antennas. So they all radiate in unison, they cooperate, and can regenerate this light pulse so we can get the information back out into the light field. So with this system, we actually have a unique system whereby we can take light, turn it into matter, and back into light with absolutely no loss of information. And of course, once you have light in matter form, it's easy, really easy to manipulate. And you could actually grab onto that matter copy, put it on the shelf, and then later let it go and turn it back into light. Or while you're holding onto it, why not start manipulating it, massaging it, change its shape, its information content. Whatever changes you make to the matter copy will be in the light pulse when you turn it back into light. And now you might say, gee, how long could we hold on to this guy? Well, clearly a couple of milliseconds. But lately, we can actually hold on to it for several seconds, and we're actually approaching minutes. And to set the scale here, in a matter of just a few seconds, light can go back and forth to the moon. With this system, we really have a new paradigm for optical information processing. Of course, we love to encode information in light and send it down optical fibers because we have high bandwidth, high data transfer rates. And with this system, we can now take that information at particular nodes, turn it into matter, massage it, and really do very powerful processing. And then once we are done, turn it back into light and send it down another optical fiber. And I would say that so far we have really only started to touch the tip of the iceberg of this system. And to maybe tie up to the talk just before, we actually have experiments going on in the lab where we are combining nanotubes with cold atoms to try to start to squeeze this whole structure and these kind of properties down onto the nanoscale. But I'm out of time here. Thank you.